Her talk is entitled All the Isms, the Interconnections Between Social Justice Activism in Northwest Indiana. Welcome, Laurel. So I'm going to speak from the podium only because of the microphone. And as a disability rights advocate, I know that the way sometimes hearing impairment works is not so much that you can't hear someone's voice in terms of volume, is that you maybe can't discern what's being said. So I'm going to stand stationary here. Okay. So I do not have a single slide because I thought that everybody else would be so well prepared that we could kind of just dig in and talk about kind of the experience of what all these things look like. And what I'm going to talk about is a little bit of my personal experience with living in Northwest Indiana and from my family's perspective, how all of these things worked out. So, as was stated, I'm a co-organizer with Black Lives Matter Gary. And we really have so many connections with people all over the region in the Chicagoland area, because what people deal with in terms of environmental justice, in terms of racial justice, in terms of social class justice, is really very much interconnected. I know that the word a lot of people associate this with is intersectionality. For me, when I say that word, or when I think of that word, I think about that literal intersection, right? But to me, you still have people coming from different places, adjoining at one spot, and then going off into different places. And that still never really spoke to my reality or to my experience dealing with all of these isms, right? As a lifelong resident of East Chicago, Indiana, and then for a very brief time, Chicago Heights and East Chicago Heights, now known as Ford Heights, Illinois, environmental justice has been, or environmental injustice has been a part of my life always. Well, what became known as Ford Heights, Illinois. Is everybody familiar with Ford Heights? Has everybody heard the name of that city? East Chicago Heights. Marion Catholic High School, my alma mater, is in Chicago Heights. And then you have an area that's closer to Indiana, Ford Heights. And they were trying to attract the Ford Motor Company to build their plant in the city. So they changed the name of the city before the Ford Motor Company committed to building the plant. The Ford Motor Company built the plant literally across the street in Chicago Heights from where Ford Heights is. I always thought that was interesting. In Ford Heights, I remember as a child, when we moved there, the water used to fascinate me coming out of the tap. And it fascinated me because of the different colors that the water would turn. It would be an orange one minute, and then it would be maybe like a bright yellow the next minute, and then it would be like a dark brown the next minute. And it would just fascinate me. I would watch, my mother would enrage my mother because I would just watch the water come out of the tap. I had never seen anything like that. So very early on, we connected water to something that was extremely unhealthy, at least for us. Every 2 weeks, we would collect milk jugs and take them to Gary, Indiana, to my stepfather's relatives' houses, and fill these milk jugs with water from their spigot, from the side of their house, and then take them back home. Because of course, we couldn't drink that water. We bathed in it, right? I mean, we did what we could to kind of shield ourselves from the toxins that were obviously in the water. And we cooked with it, boiling it first usually, right? But that was my first and early memories in terms of, I guess, our action to starve off the water injustice. In terms of thinking about what to say today, I look back at the biography that I had written. And specifically the topic is the environment. But you really can't separate, again, the experiences of race, social class, environment, accessibility or disability rights from people's lives. You can't separate environmental racism from this conversation. I was a member of a manifestation of the Indiana Green Party in Northwest Indiana, right after I participated in a group called the Coalition for a Clean Environment that did a lot of activism around that chemical disposal facility that was later built in East Chicago. The city of East Chicago sold a plot of land next to a high school, across the street from a junior high school, where they were going to put a stone cylinder. They weren't going to layer the bottom. They weren't going to build a top for it. They were just going to dredge that barge the ships came through and dump the sediment in that stone cylinder. So of course, when it rained, when it was very hot, right, you had those, you know, look like those little cartoon wavy lines that are coming up out of it and being dispersed through the air, right? That absolutely happened. We starved that off for maybe a good year, right? But of course, in terms of for-profit industry, it was inevitable what was going to happen with that. They were going to build it. They did continue to poison the community. That's just how that story goes. But later, being a part of the Northwest Indiana Green Party, that name came right back to me. I didn't remember it until right then. The Northwest Indiana Green Party, we had a conversation about how we could become more active in our immediate area. And everybody is throwing out ideas for issues that we could talk about. And I raised my hand. I was the only black person in this group. We all had a connection through being either employed or a student at Purdue, then Purdue Calumet, now Purdue Northwest Hammond. And I kind of raised my hand and I said, you know, we really should be talking about, if we want people in this area to be involved, we should be talking about environmental racism. And the silence that spread across the landscape of the cafe we were having this meeting in was amazing. And I kind of knew that would be the reaction, not because of maliciousness, but because this group, and I would say then, the environmental rights movement at that time wasn't really geared towards racial justice in that way. That wasn't really at the forefront of the conversation that group at that time was having. But being a lifelong resident of East Chicago, Indiana, my family coming from a neighborhood called New Addition, which across the street from my family house, you had BP oil tankers. And I remember thinking, you know, that's the one that's shaped like a baseball, that's the one that's shaped like a hot dog, because it was that close to my family's home. And then later, moving a few blocks east into the harbor area, coming outside, getting in my car, driving to college, and having my car covered with this sticky sediment, you know, sometimes during the summer, most times during the summer, not really so much in the winter. But these issues of environmental justice and then environmental racism was salient in my life. And I thought, I'm definitely not the only one experiencing it. So if we're in an environmental group, this should be part of what we're talking about. And spoiler alert, we didn't. The people who were involved in it didn't really know how to address that. They didn't know how to, again, there was only one non-white member of this group, me. And at that time was a lot of the struggle that the environmental rights activists faced who were quote unquote of color or non-white. How do we kind of bridge the issue of racial justice and environmental justice together? It was difficult. And in that instance, it didn't happen. It didn't happen very well. It didn't happen outside of our awkward communications with each other, for sure. And this experience isn't just limited to this part of the country. I mean, we all know now it's about the Flint, Michigan tragedy that's still ongoing. The situation in Ford Heights is still ongoing, right? In a study titled Evaluating the Relative Environmental Impact of Countries, there are 7 indicators of environmental degradation that are listed. Natural forest loss, habitat conversion, marine captures, fertilizer use, water pollution, carbon emissions, and species threat. Among my cousins and I, and other young people in East Chicago, there's one thing that you know, right? You don't drink the water, right? Older folks drink the water because they've been drinking the water all along, and you know, they haven't grown a third eye yet. It might not be that bad. Right, but if you're about 40 or under, you really don't drink the water in these areas. And for that to be something that's known, it's a colloquialism. It's very interesting. I was just kind of laughing with Thomas about right after the situation in the West Calumet area in Chicago kind of exploded. Maybe about a month or two later, I saw this front page story about Valparaiso. And it was literally front page, big, bold, black letters, you know, lead found in Valparaiso. And I kind of just looked at it and kind of went, huh, okay, really? Of course it is. Of course it is. You can't have an environmental tragedy like what's happening in specifically in East Chicago not affect the rest of the area. You just can't, right? But there are certain buffers put into place for some of us to feel it more, for some of us to be forced to feel it more. Generational illness, early death, perpetual illness ourselves. And then you have urban blight. You have a lack of resources. You have the inability of the resources in your community to take care of people when they do succumb to these sicknesses that have to do directly with the pursuit of profit over the well-being of people. In the same article, the top 10 countries with the most environmental threats are listed. The United States is placed at number 2 on that list. The United States is second to Brazil, which is the first, and it's followed by the third country, which is China. The United States ranked first for carbon emissions, second for water pollution, third for marine captures, and ninth for threatened species. And in all of these areas, what these countries have in common is the population of working class people that bear the brunt of these profit-driven abuses. We can't get away from that. We can't get away from the reason why. That's the best question that you can ever ask in any class, particularly sociology. Why? And you keep having to ask that question. Very young children, we dissuade them from asking why too many times because ultimately we're gonna run out of answers. I think as we get older, there are answers. The answers are there. They're very uncomfortable. It's very unfortunate. Sometimes we don't want to hear it, but that question of why has to be answered. I pulled out some quotes from Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that we may not be so familiar with. In 1967, while addressing the members of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, Dr. King said that the evils of capitalism are as real as the evils of militarism and the evils of racism. I'll read it again. The evils of capitalism are as real as the evils of militarism and the evils of racism. We don't have school today, but we go do a little lecture. What's capitalism? Anybody? A layman's definition. What's capitalism? Holler it out. What's capitalism?
Buying and selling.
Buying and selling. What else is capitalism?
Supply and demand.
Supply and demand. What else is capitalism?
Profit over people.
Profit over people. Hashtag profit over people. What else is capitalism?
Private industry.
Private industry. Anything else?
Free markets.
Free market. Well, free for some. Not free for everyone. What else is capitalism? Anything else? Any thoughts? Anything that jumps in your head?
No measurement for externalities.
I'm sorry?
No measurement for externalities.
No measurement for externalities. Okay. Anything else? Anything else?
Money.
Money. Take in more money than you put out. And if you don't take in more money than you put out, then you get that money from somebody else or somewhere else. Which goes right into the definition of power. Being able to do what you want, regardless of what other people want. Right? Because I'm sure nobody wants to live in these communities that are toxic. I played in the yards of West Calumet. I had relatives that lived there. Particularly, I used to get my hair done there. I used to get my Jerry curl put in on my eye. We played in the dirt. We ran around in shorts. We splashed around in the standing water. All the things that there are signs on people's lawns telling people over and over again not to let their children do. And they still do, because you can't keep a kid locked up. This is where these people live, right? This is their home. This has been their generational home. And it's been poisoned. It didn't just get poisoned. It's been poisoned. So think of the generational damage that has been done over time. How can you repay that? That's another question. It's not necessarily rhetorical. If you have an idea, yell it out. How can you repay that? How can you remunerate that? What can you give somebody to make up for that? The woman in the first slide in the picture, I believe it was Maritza, has lost her entire family. I'm not sure if many made it into their 70s. Her entire family. To now what can be tied back to this poisoning in that community. Who pays for that? We live in a capitalist society. We deal with money. Who pays for that? How can you pay for it? Where does the reimbursement start? How far back do you have to go? Because when you put it in terms of money, I think that's where these corporations come in. That's where they have to be held accountable. Very few people are willing to say that. And this is built into the system. It's not a mistake. It's not a horrible accident. There are people that get paid more money than me to calculate the human cost of doing this type of business. And in those equations, they have dictated that these people's lives, the lives of my family, the life of myself, I've not gotten myself that tested. I'll admit, I just didn't want to know. Right? Who calculates that? What dollar value is put on that? How do we justify it? Because I guarantee somebody in here is thinking, well, it happened so long ago, who really has to pay for that? But we live in a capitalist society. We deal with money, right? Somebody has to be responsible. Send my check. Send it to my house. The evils of materialism and the evils of racism. Profit over people, that's a big one. It was towards the end of his life that Dr. King became increasingly vocal about connecting the dots of power and oppression both inside and outside this country. This is when he began to be a real threat. This is towards, again, the end of his life. When he began to reach across the spectrum of race and nationality, joining in solidarity with people whose oppression was tied to economic superiority of a ruling class, it was then that he became the biggest threat imaginable to that power majority. When the full depths of the damage done in the West Calumet neighborhood of East Chicago came to light, the potential activism of that area was staggering. And again, these are things that we knew. From living in this area, we knew that we were being poisoned. We knew it. Right? We knew it. But for the first time, you had enough people who knew it at the right time to do something about it. And that's what all of this culminates into. I got like four more pages. We won't get to that. Another quote, the problems of racial injustice and economic injustice cannot be solved without a radical redistribution of power, redistribution of political and economic power. The Me Too movement, tie that together real quick. You have Oprah Winfrey who made this, I don't watch award shows. I like Star Trek all day, all night, Star Trek. So I don't watch the award show. But I did see a piece of the speech that she gave about seeking justice for people who had been abused through the wielding of unchecked power in Hollywood. And then I saw pictures of her embracing one of the main offenders of that power, a person with a long line of mental and sexual and physical abuse of people. I saw Barbara Walters do an interview with Corey Feldman and try to discredit his claims of he and Corey Haim's long-standing sexual abuse. What do these things have in common? The abuse of power, the silencing of the victims of this power, and the co-opting of this suffering. Another quote from Dr. King, revolution of values, from a speech he gave in 1967. When machines and computers, profit motive and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, extreme materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. If I could, I'd like to add to Dr. King's quote, except in the face of multiracial, multigenerational, accessible, anti-sexist, anti-racist unity in the form of activism. And we have that. We have that. In all of these small spaces, we have that. We have people doing small things that can amount to giant things. I'm a disability rights advocate with Everybody Counts North and Hammond. We did an action with a group called Adapt Indiana, where we went to talk about the cutting of Medicare or Medicaid, right? Because people with disabilities are some of the majority of the folks who suffer under the ravages of environmental racism. And there was a reaction to that. There was a reaction by the power structure. That reaction landed me on my back with an ambulance surrounded by about 9 US Marshals. But without that action, where are we? Last quote, again, we have deluded ourselves into believing the myth that capitalism grew and prospered out of the Protestant ethic of hard work and sacrifice. The fact is that capitalism was built on the exploitation and suffering of black slaves and continues to thrive on the exploitation of poor, both black and white, both here and abroad. From The Three Evils of Society, delivered by King in 1967. No wonder he was killed very soon after. That's dangerous. That kind of talk is dangerous. Uniting the suffering of people, not just within a country, but across national borders, is dangerous. But if we can unite the suffering of people here in Northwest Indiana against these almost insignificant borders, that can be as dangerous. And it's necessary if we're to go on, if we're to win. And we can. We have small victories, but we have to unite for action to win these large victories. I think my time might be up. So real quick, I want to say that Black Lives Matter Gary is doing a movie show of a documentary called Who Streets. And it's going to be at Indiana University Northwest. And as I frantically go to my calendar, we will be showing that movie on Thursday, January the 25th, in Berglund Auditorium. And it's a documentary about the bravery of the very young people who are also ravaged by environmental injustice and economic injustice in Ferguson, and how they're able to live their lives while being these social justice warriors, something that may seem impossible, but it became possible because it was necessary for their survival. Thank you, everyone.